Well, we're in a series called City Church, where we're talking about what it means to be a good local church in Little Rock, Arkansas. And we've said all along that the direction we're headed is towards evangelism, generational generosity, and racial reconciliation. And I want to tell you, this matters so much to me. This may be the main reason I started feeling a tug back to Arkansas a couple of years ago. When all the stuff was happening with Ferguson and Baltimore and all these different kind of flashpoints of racial irreconciliation throughout our country, I kept thinking, Arkansas might be next. Because I grew up here. I love this place, and I also know our struggles. So a couple of years ago, I went on a bus ride led by Jerry Taylor, a black preacher in Abilene, Texas, and we went with 10 black preachers and 10 white preachers in Churches of Christ, and we went all over the civil rights area of the Southeast, specifically in Alabama. And at one point, we actually got to sit down and visit for like a day with Brother Fred Gray. How many of y'all know who Fred Gray is? Just show of hands. Yeah, he was Dr. King's lawyer. He was Rosa Parks' lawyer. He was the lawyer for the Tuskegee lawsuit and also Brown versus the Board of Education. But what a lot of people don't know is on top of doing that, he was also a Church of Christ preacher. He was and is a Church of Christ preacher. A really incredible day getting to spend time with him. At one point, Brother Fred, we were all on the bus. We're about to go to the next thing. And Brother Fred gets on the bus with us. And every one of us preachers stood up and we're like, "Would you like our seat, Brother Fred?" Because he kind of made a big deal about the last time somebody didn't get a seat on a bus. So today I want to do a sermon in two parts. Part one, a brief history of racism. This isn't a sermon on racism, but I want you to see that racism is in the Bible. Not because it's in the Bible, but because it's in our hearts. So when God first creates Adam and Eve, when we first meet Adam meeting Eve, we're told that Adam says, "She is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh." And then the next people that were introduced are Cain and Abel, and we're told that Cain watched the flocks and Abel tended the soil. When we first see Adam meeting Eve, we're introduced to them by their similarities. But after sin has entered the world, we're introduced to them by their differences. And that's been the case ever since. Cain and Abel, at one point, they get into an argument, basically the very first worship war. And Cain is upset that his brother's worship or sacrifice is more honoring to God. And so Cain rises up and kills him. But what's interesting is what God says in response to Cain murdering his brother Abel. Because Cain thought that by killing his brother, he would silence Abel. But God comes to Cain and says, "The blood of your brother cries out to me." It did not silence his brother. It amplified it. Because God hears everything. God hears the ways we hurt one another. And I think God's ears these days are hurting. Because I think God has very big ears. You know, what's interesting to me about Genesis 1 and 2 is that when Adam and Eve are made, it does not tell us what race they are. It doesn't tell us what color they are. It doesn't tell us anything about them. It doesn't even tell us that they're Jewish. The word Adam just means like humankind. Their race is not identifiable. The division of humanity into races doesn't come until a few chapters later in Genesis chapter 10, the Table of Nations, preceded immediately by the the Tower of Babel. What's interesting to me, though, is that the first 11 chapters of Genesis have been read by a specific group of people, namely slave owners in the South, in a way that nobody in human history, no Christian in human history before that, read it that way. Like, for example, how many of y'all have heard, you're not raising your hand to say, "I believe this," but that you've heard this, that the mark of Cain, that when God sends Cain off, that the mark of Cain was God making Cain black. How many of y'all have heard that? Yeah, me too. How about when God curses Ham? When the Noah story happens, God curses Ham. That was the same thing. Anybody heard that? Yeah, the truth is nobody knows why God curses Ham. It could be like a kosher thing or something. That's a joke. That'll catch up with you in a second. But nobody read the Bible that way before, honestly, except a group of people who had a very vested interest in being able to use other people. But for the most part, nobody read the Bible that way until like the 18th century. And maybe for those of you who are on the outside of the Christian faith, or you're just, you know, maybe new to this thing, maybe you'll take heart in knowing that global Christianity never read the Bible like that. In fact, globally, Christians came out very quickly against slavery. Christians, you know, like Catholics and Quakers, they came out very quickly against the idea that you could use another human being and say, somehow dehumanize them. This didn't come from the Bible. It came from our hearts, which, of course, the Bible is very honest about. Because we're not the first ones to think like this. So in the very next book of the Bible, in the book of Genesis, or the book of Exodus, the people of God are in slavery, right? They're in the they're in Egypt, they're in oppression, and then God delivers these people, the Jewish people, from slavery. And just a few chapters after they're delivered from slavery, Miriam, Moses' sister, who has heard about her brother has married a person of another ethnicity, Moses' sister starts talking bad about Moses. So does anybody remember what God does to Miriam? He gives her leprosy. You want to know what the commentators call that story? I kid you not, the curse of whiteness. I didn't hear the slave owners talk about that story growing up, right? That's called white disprivilege. And the reason this is an important thing is because Miriam had been talking about Moses' marrying a woman from another ethnicity, and God punishes Miriam by making her on the outside of the community. She was unclean for like a week. God let her see what it felt like. Now, what's interesting to me is that Miriam had just been a part of a group of slaves. She had just been brought out of slavery, and as soon as they're released from their oppression, Miriam turns around and starts that whole system over again. Because this is not really just something that one group of people struggle with. This is something that is in every one of our hearts. That's what is happening in the book of Exodus. It gets worse. A couple of books later in the book of Judges, which is hands down the worst book in the Bible, the darkest book of the Bible. I have a lot of friends who lost their faith in the book of Judges. A couple of things to say about that. The book of Judges is written descriptively, not prescriptively. It is not saying this is how things should be. It is saying this is how things are. When everybody's trying to live for themselves, watch out for themselves. And in Judges chapter 12, we find out Israel isn't just, they're not racist. They're tribalist. There are people that look just like them but are born in a different tribe and grew up in a different area, and they decide to hate those people. Like, so for example, there's all this tribe of Ephraim. The people of Gilead hate the Ephraimites. So they decide they're going to commit genocide on the Ephraimites. The problem is they all look like Gileads. They all look like each other. They're all Jews. So they remember, hey, you know what? The Ephraimites live from another place, and they have like this thing where they can't say a certain word. So what we're going to do is we're going to set up a ford, and then for all the Ephraimites who are trying to sneak past, we're going to ask them to say this word, and if they can't say it, we'll know they're an Ephraimite, and we'll kill them. So this is in Judges chapter 12, starting in verse 5. Here's what it says. The Gileads captured the ford over the Jordan leading to Ephraimite. And whenever a survivor of Ephraim said, "Let me cross over," the men of Gilead asked, "Are you an Ephraimite?" If he replied no, they said, "All right, say Shibboleth." And if he said Sibboleth because he could not pronounce the word correctly, they seized him and killed them at the fords of Jordan. 42,000 Ephraimites were killed at that time. It's not just about what your skin color is. This sin that is in every human, this sin, it divides the world up into so many different ways. It can be people who look just like you, but they are just from a different tribe. It gets worse. You know, the book of Jonah isn't about a well. We've made it about a well because it's easier for us. You know what the book of Jonah is about? It's about this. Because remember, God tells Jonah, "I want you to go preach to the who? Ninevites, the Assyrians, the Israelites' enemies." And they had good reasons to hate the Assyrians. And Jonah had his reasons. So where God tells him to go talk to Assyrians, he says no. He goes the opposite direction. And it's not towards the end of the book you begin to realize the reason Jonah doesn't want to go isn't because he's worried they won't believe him and they'll kill him. The reason Jonah doesn't want to go is because he's worried they will believe him. And he knows God. He knows God can't be trusted to treat the people he hates the way he wants him to treat them. I like the way Anne Lamott says this. She says, "You can safely assume you have made God in your own image when it turns out God hates all the same people you do." But Jonah hasn't made God in his image, and that's his problem. He knows he can't trust God to hate the people he hates. Just a little pushback to this idea that's out there these days. I've heard often that a lot of people say, you know what we're doing today is really just this big human dream. It's a human construct. Humans needed something transcendent to worship, something bigger than themselves. They needed heaven so they wouldn't feel bad about dying, those kind of things. So we just created this whole thing. That's what we're doing today. It's a human construct. A little pushback to that idea. If God is just something that we invented, what kind of people would create a God like this? What kind of people would create a God with the story of Jonah in it, right? What kind of people would create a God and say, you know what this God says? This God says, if you want to know how well you're loving me, look at how you treat the people you like the least. What kind of people would make a God like this? Does it surprise anybody else? This, by the way, is in much more of the Old Testament, but I'm going to move on to the New Testament. Does it surprise anybody else that Jesus addresses this in his very first sermon? Look at Luke chapter 4, verse 24. In Luke chapter 4, Jesus is preaching, and at first the people are like, wow, the carpenter's kid is good. And then he gets to point three. He says, truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time when the sky was shut for 3.5 years and there was a severe famine throughout the land, yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha the prophet, and yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian. Remember Assyrians, how they hate Syrians? All the people in the synagogue were furious with him when he heard this. They got up and drove him out of town and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to throw him off the cliff. My very first sermon to preach, they took me to Burger King afterwards and patted me on the back and told me what a great job I did. Jesus' first sermon to preach, they try to throw him off a cliff, which is interesting because earlier in this chapter, you want to know what Satan was doing? Satan was trying to get Jesus to go off a cliff. And just later in this chapter, we find out the people of God are doing the work of Satan. Does it surprise anybody else to find out that Jesus' most famous sermon, his most famous parable for a lot of people, the Good Samaritan, we've told that story in so many different ways, but what it's about is this: racism. Jewish people hated Samaritans. They hated them. They were seen as half-breeds. They despised them. There was a theory going around that they didn't have souls. And so at one point, Jesus is saying, you should love your neighbor. And this teacher of the law, who thinks Jesus is a little slippery, raises his hand and he goes, hey, who is my neighbor? And so Jesus tells him the story that maybe you're familiar with about a man who is robbed and he's beaten up and he's stripped naked and he's unconscious. And all that matters because what it means is that nobody who was passing him by would know anything about him. He was unconscious, so he can't talk. You don't know what accent he has. You don't know what language he speaks. All you know is that this is a human being who is very vulnerable and wounded. And then he tells about a couple of prestigious people that walk by, preachers, priests, the people who like you would expect to help other people, and they just keep on walking. And this was a common storytelling thing back in the day Jesus does this. So you would expect that the next person is going to be like somebody really significant. And then Jesus says, along comes a Samaritan. And then he basically is saying to the man who says, well, who is my neighbor? He's saying, who would you want to take care of you if you were in that situation? And the man's racism runs so deep. This is how he responds. He can't even say it. Which one of these do you think was a neighbor? And the expert in the law does not say Samaritan. He says the one who had mercy on him. You may think that's a little bit of a stretch. So how about this? In John chapter 8, the Pharisees accuse Jesus. They go to him and they say, you know what? The rumor on the street is that you are a Samaritan and demon-possessed. And I like how casually they say this. Like, hey, you know, we're just confirming what everybody knows. You're a Samaritan and you're demon-possessed. And Jesus is a ninja here. Look at what he does. He does not cooperate with their racism. They say, aren't you a demon-possessed? And aren't you demon-possessed and a Samaritan? And Jesus goes, I'm not demon-possessed. Isn't that brilliant? He's not going to cooperate with their idea that somehow Samaritans are less human than other people. There's more. You remember that story of Jesus turning over the table in the temples? You remember when he does that? We turn that into saying, you know, if you ever sell coffee in your church, you need to pitch a fit. That is not what that's about. I get that there's a reason to be worried about people trying to make a buck off God's name. Don't want to be that person. But what this story is about isn't that. Jesus goes into the court of the Gentiles where the Jewish people had set up selling their wares right there. Do you know what the court of the Gentiles, we have in the Israeli Museum, there's actually this stone written in Koine Greek, which is the common language for everybody. And it says, if you are not a Jew and you go any further, you will die. We will kill you. They had started selling, the one place Gentiles could go in the Jewish temple, they had set up and they had started selling there. So Jesus, he gets cranked up. He makes a whip like he's some kind of Indiana Jones and goes in there and turns the table over in the temple. And you remember what he says? It is written, my Father's house is supposed to be a house for what? All nations. All nations. Ta, ethne. It's where we get the word ethnicity. My Father's house is supposed to be a place for all nations, but it wasn't. The God of Israel was supposed to be a God for all people. Abraham was supposed to be a father to all nations, a blessing to all nations, but he wasn't. Until part two of this sermon, the Apostle Paul, it takes one to know one. Because after Jesus is killed and then raised from the dead, there's another Jewish leader, a guy named Saul, who was basically originally the Jewish ISIS of his day. And Saul has this encounter with Jesus that it changes everything for him. Namely, it changes two things. One, he learns Jesus is alive and has defeated death. And he learned he had been killing the people of God. Now imagine if you're Saul. Imagine, and Saul's not doing this to be a jerk. Saul's doing what he's doing to try to honor God. He's going around killing these Christians, persecuting these Christians because he's trying to honor God. And now, all of a sudden, you think the things that you've been doing in service to God, you realize, you know, you've been excluding, condemning, making policy against, and taking violence against these people. And now, all of a sudden, you find out you're wrong. That's not who God is. And this Saul, this master of the Jewish scriptures, all of a sudden realizes, I'm Cain. I've killed my brother. So you know what he does? He goes all over the world planting churches of the new people of Abraham, the father of all nations. And Paul becomes the reverse Jonah. Where Jonah said no, Paul says yes, over and over, and shipwreck again. He becomes the new Shibboleth gatekeeper, but this time he's going to make sure the gate stays open. He goes to those widows of Isaiah, the foreigners and family that Jesus talked about in his first sermon, and he starts churches, temples, places where the Holy Spirit dwells when we gather together, and he calls it to be a house of prayer for all nations, and he turns over the tables in those temples when they don't. That's what's happening in 1 Corinthians. At the table, they were excluding certain groups of people, and Paul, like Jesus before him, gets very cranked up about it. He goes all over the world telling people about the family of Abraham and calling people who he has no blood relationship with brother and sister, and he means it. He tells everybody that Jesus is the king of the universe. He's the first person in human history who would have told the Gentiles that everyone is equal. If you believe that everyone is equal today, it's because of Paul. The reason you're here today is because Paul got the gospel outside of the 30-mile area of Palestine and went around telling people this radical idea that we assume is self-evident but is anything but. Your Declaration of Independence is lying to you. It is not self-evident that all people are created equal. The opposite is self-evident. That is a very Christian idea that came from Paul making sure everybody knew. In Jesus, everything is different here. Today, there are certain things that we think are right and wrong, certain things that we think are, you know, important, and you have no idea The problem we have with Paul, honestly, is that we read in an air-conditioned room these radical ideas that changed the world, that he sweat, bled, shipwrecked, was stoned and beaten to make sure got all over the world. Did you know back in the ancient world, pity wasn't seen as a virtue? It was seen as weakness. Being a victim had no kind of moral status. It meant that you were a loser. That's what it meant. But our world has changed because the gospel has changed the world through these little churches that Paul planted around a God who says, "My strength is made perfect in weakness." Before Martin Luther King Jr. had a dream, Paul had a vision, and it's one we need more than ever today. So when I was 16 years old, I was driving from the little 10-person church that I grew up in. I'll tell you more about that next week. But I was driving from that, and I was taking my friend Brian home. I was in my parents' minivan, because that's real cool to pick up the ladies in. And growing up, there was this place in Benton that maybe a lot of you know of, The Hill. I would say that growing up, I never heard my parents say anything racist, but we were segregated. We lived segregated. And The Hill was where they lived, people who were different than me. And I never went on The Hill. Except this one time, after I dropped Brian off, I wanted our family, our house kind of was close to The Hill, so I took a shortcut through The Hill. And my van broke down on a Sunday afternoon. This was pre-cell phone. There was no way to, do anything. So I just kind of sat by the van and tried to wave people down. And finally, a car with four black women pulled over. And they said, "What's going on?" I told them. They said, "Well, you can come to our house and you can use our phone." So I get in the back of the car with them. And I have never had an experience like this. We're driving along. I got that Sesame Street song playing in my head. "One of these things is not like the other," you know. And as we go over this kind of slope, I see the biggest man I had ever seen in my life up until that point, a guy named Tyrell, I found out later. Tyrell is just a giant. And we start pulling over to talk to Tyrell, which I think is a bad idea. Anyway, they roll the window down, and Tyrell leans in, and these women say, "Tyrell, we got us a new man now." To which I was like, "Oh, no, Tyrell. You're the man, Tyrell." And this guy who'd never met me before reaches in. It's a holy moment for me. He reaches in. He goes, "Well, then welcome to the family." And everything changed for me. I mean, I started to think maybe these preconceptions that I've had, just they're not, they don't really fit the realities. So in that group of 10 black preachers and 10 white preachers, I told that story. And this preacher named Reggie, he told me, another story, about 10 years ago, something like that happened to him. He'd gotten to a part in his life where some stuff had happened, and his heart was starting to get hard towards some white people because of some things that had happened. And he had started to think in more sweeping generalizations than he wanted to. And at one point, his car broke down, and this 90-pound white woman pulled over. Reggie's a big man, pulled over and helped him fix his car and then drove off. And he had the same kind of moment. We just realized those sweeping generalizations, they're like this, that must be like, those just didn't work. And we also, both Reggie and I, realized sometimes God breaks your car down just to do stuff like this to you. Whenever racism becomes a talking point in the media, whenever the next Ferguson, whenever the next Baltimore happens, whenever the next Dallas happens, whenever the next, flashpoint happens, I cringe every time. You want to know why? Because here's what I know we do. We rush to our talking points. We go to, I have a friend who. And Christians don't do the one thing that could actually be a part of the healing of the nations. You want to know what it is? Confess. So if leadership is going first, let me go first. I'm a racist. I don't want to be. I grew up in southern Benton, Arkansas in the 80s, and I grew up with the Confederate flag hanging on my wall. I had a shirt that said on the Confederate flag, "You wear your X and I'll wear mine. And I did not take that shirt off. Even when someone pointed a loaded shotgun at my face, I didn't change that shirt. I did, however, have to change my pants later. But I did not take off that shirt because of a shotgun. I took off that shirt because of water. You want to know when people ask me my conversion story? For 15 years plus, I've told them this. I got baptized a few months after that story happened with being on the hill. And a few weeks after I got baptized, I'm driving along in Benton, Salem, Arkansas. Some of y'all have even been to the home that this happened at. We're driving on my street, and a black family had just moved into our neighborhood, the very first black family. And I'm with some of my best friends, and we're driving along, and they want me to yell the N-word. And I wouldn't do it. And I wouldn't say it was the most Christian moment in my life, because we actually got in a fist fight over it. And I lost the friendships and the fist fight. But I had to walk 4 miles to go to the basketball practice I was going to, and the whole time I was smiling after that. Not because I'd lost the friendships, but because of that day I knew I was a Christian. I knew I was a Christian more than I was an Arkansan, more than I was a good old boy, more than I was a redneck or an American. I was a Christian. That's my conversion, or at least the start of it. And I've come to realize that on some level, it doesn't have to look like white, black, racism. It doesn't have, but it's in everybody's heart. Everybody's heart has this. If you belong to the new humanity, that's part of your conversion. If you've been baptized, you realize the labels of this world just do not apply anymore inside this building or outside this building. You do not accept skin color or the way other people vote or anything as a way to primarily identify. That is a Christian idea. Listen, if you're not a Christian, I cannot think of one good reason why racism is a sin. I can't think of one single reason why racism is wrong if you're not a Christian. For thousands of years, people thought, of course you would love your people, the people that look like you and think like you, more than you would love anybody else. For thousands of years, that's been the dominant story in human history. Outside of Jesus changing everything, I cannot think of why the world thinks it's wrong. And shortly, they're going to start realizing that. Maybe even they are already. But Paul would say, if you are in Christ, everything has changed. Actually, that's exactly what Paul says. Look in 2 Corinthians 5. Paul says, us inside the church, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. What's a worldly point of view? I think we get what a worldly point of view is these days. We once regarded Christ in this way, but we don't any longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, and the new is here. All this is from God. God gave you this. God has reconciled us. We couldn't do this on our own, but God has reconciled us and given us the ministry of reconciliation. Or what about what Paul says in Colossians 3? Do not lie to each other. You've taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge of the image of its creator. In here, it's different. Church is different. In here, there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, those, by the way, would have been enemies, slave or free. Christ is all and is in all. Or the passage that was read earlier today, Galatians 3, when Paul says, don't you know that when you got baptized, it changed everything? Now there's neither slave nor free, male nor female, Jew nor Gentile. Do you know in Acts 2, you want to know what's happening there? It's a reversal of the curse of Babel. God is undoing the curse of Babel. Do you know that up until that point, up until Acts 2, every time there was a roll call or a number, a population number that was given, it always just counted the men. But in Acts 2, it counted the children and the women as well. And for the rest of the New Testament, it does. That's the church Paul is trying to start. Do you know that kindness comes from the word kin? Because you like people who are like you, right? You like people who are related to you. But Paul goes all over the world planting churches of a different kind because Jesus had a different vision that his people, his bride, because of his work on the cross, were not trying to build their identity on who they were against, but on what Jesus had done. So at one point, at one of those civil rights memorials, we're at this church in Birmingham. It's a church where a KKK member had placed a bomb and had killed four little black girls. And if you got any kind of heart sitting there hearing the story, it's just devastating. And we're all thinking, why would anybody do this? And then all of a sudden it dawned on me. You know, they got the target right. If you want to destroy this kind of vision for justice and equality and human dignity, you don't bomb the Department of Justice. You don't bomb Washington. If you want to destroy this kind of vision, they got the target right. Because this place didn't come from Washington. It may wind up there, but it started in the church. You want to know my favorite thing about that Martin Luther King Jr. I Have a Dream speech, that March for Rights? My favorite thing of that son, his I Have a Dream speech is looking at the crowd. You want to know what they're wearing? They're wearing their suits and their dresses. And you want to know why? Because they had just come from church. This whole thing came from church. This hope started in a manger and it ran through the pens of a man who wrote letters from prison. It is the hope of the world. It is the healing of the nations. Do you know what church is? The church is the dream of Jesus. It is the hope of the world. It is the hope of sinners and the life of saints. It is a city on a hill. It is the counterculture for the good of culture. That's what church is. It is the life of tomorrow right here today. That's the church Jesus started and Paul planted. It's the church we're called to be, a church within a city, a city within a city, a church of difference that can make a difference for the healing of the nations and the glory of God. Let's stand and give God glory together now.